Buddhists and Christians around the world have entered into dialogue. And as this dialogue has deepened, some of them have taken it within themselves. They have not only studied the beliefs of their dialogue partners, but have gone on voyages of discovery that embrace both Buddhist and Christian spiritual practices. In this series of profiles, we are going to meet some of these explorers and listen to the stories of their inner journeys.
I'm Ruben Habito, and I was born in the Philippines. And when I was in my mid-teens, I felt an inner call to enter the religious life or somehow to pursue some basic issues about life and death at that early age. And so I wound up in the novitiate of the Society of Jesus there. And it gave me a very good foundation for what is known as the spiritual exercises of Saint Ignatius. And I'm grateful for that throughout my life. And so going through the formation of the Society of Jesus, we also were given the opportunity to consider those issues, not just from the point of view of practice with the spiritual exercises, but also intellectually with philosophical and theological studies. And it was during that period of my life when I felt another call based on the first, that there was this country, Japan, which is just literally a jet stone's throw from the Philippines, but which was open for the kind of work that the Society of Jesus was doing. And so with that, in 1970, I was sent to Japan to the province of the Society of Jesus over there. And that's what gave me the basis for learning more about Japanese culture and Japanese spirituality. So at that point of my life, I was living in a place called Kamakura, where the language school was, and that's where I met Father Thomas Hand, who already had been doing Zen with Yamada Roshi. And so he suggested that I also take that opportunity to do some Zen. And so that's how it all started. Yes, well, when I joined the group in Kamakura, there were already some Marinol sisters and of course Father Hand who were practicing. And somehow that gave a sense of assurance to other Christians that, yes, you can practice this spiritual path, which comes from the Buddhist tradition, and yet be continuing as a Christian, continuing your commitment as a Christian and your own faith vision. And so in that sense, their presence there was an encouragement to many of us who came later. And so Yamada Roshi also saw that, and he initiated us into the basic way of practice, just as any other, without making any distinction who was Buddhist and who was Christian. But Zen basically is an offering of a way of life and a way of practice. And so we were welcomed as seekers after truth in the same way as all the others were. Of course, he realized that we were different in the sense that we had a different set of conceptual apparatus, different sets of images with which we resonated in terms of the religious life. And so he also saw that as an opportunity to try to learn more about Christianity or the Christian gospel and so on. So that was a very initial stage that was full of so many possibilities at that point. And so more and more Christians came, and when Yamada Roshi saw that, he saw that that was something that he had to respect, or that felt he needed to respect, without telling them, no, you have to abandon that, because his predecessor Yasutani Roshi had that injunction that, well, to really practice Zen to its ultimate, you have to get rid of your concepts of God and of so many of your religious concepts, which in a sense is true. that you have to set aside concepts, because now we are dealing with something that is not liable to be encased in mere concepts, and so it has to be a purifying experience in that sense. So Yasutani Roshi was quite strong on that, but that was unfortunately interpreted as having to set aside your being Christian, which are two different things, I'd say. So the concept of God as it developed in the Christian tradition and all the other concepts, if they become little idols that we cling to, then they can be obstacles to meeting the real God in that sense. And so I read Yasutani Roshi's injunction of setting aside the concept of God in those terms. But unfortunately, people thought that, well, now you have to stop being Christian, which is a different thing altogether. And Yamada Roshi saw that, yes, people can practice in a way that they would set aside their conceptual framework, but dispose themselves to a direct experience. And so that was a kind of way we were directed by Yamada Roshi. And so those of us who were blessed with that experience in Zen were also challenged by him. Now, as you deepen in that experience, your main concern is precisely to continue purifying that experience so that it becomes a living reality in your day-to-day life. And then, from there on, as Christians, you are called to try to express that from within your own tradition. So that's how Yamada Roshi entrusted us with that kind of ongoing task, to be able to express that experience that we were also called to continue to purify in terms that could resonate with those from within that tradition. Most of us at that time were just trying to find the ropes a bit, getting our posture in a way that would be conducive to the deepening and so on. But, well, we were also given very good direction by the Roshi, so that, well, at that point, some of us started making the so-called breakthrough. And so that was when things started to change, because before that, we were considered by the Buddhists as, you know, out-of-the-way practitioners. Out-of-the-way meaning, well, that we were not in the path itself, but, well, we're just doing it, well, in their own interpretation, so that we could gain merit to go to heaven and so on. So we were somehow labeled as Gedo Zen, or heretical Zen, so to speak. But as Yamada Roshi saw that we were also practicing in exactly the same way as the others were, and some of us began to really see the point and begin to be transformed by that whole practice and that experience, then he saw that there was no sense in making that kind of distinction anymore, and that we were also disposed to really practicing Zen to its fullest. And so actually it was in 1971, late fall, I think, yeah, I believe it was November, when there was a session Zen retreat. I was not participating in that session myself, but was going to Doksan or interview with Yamada Roshi during that time, commuting from from the place where I was staying, which was the language school in Kamakura. And it was at that period when somehow all those preliminaries that we were initiated into somehow made sense to me. And all of a sudden, well, while I was sitting quietly in my room after an afternoon of Zen, I was just relaxing, doing nothing in particular. Suddenly, it just dawned on me that, yes, this is it. Well, that somehow led to a kind of an explosion, and I just burst out laughing. Why didn't I see this before? Now I know why the Buddha has that smile that covers the whole universe. And so I ran from my room and knocked at Tom Han's door and told him, hey, I got it. And so I have to call Yamada Roshi. And so I did. And so I set an appointment for Doksan with him. And so during that time, I could not help just laughing. And that kind of laughter also led to tears of joy and so on. So that kind of inner tremor remained for about 3 days or so. But anyway, so that evening I went to Yamada Roshi for the usual checks of such an experience. And so he said, well, you need to ripen it a little bit more. But I knew that I had it, but that there were just some questions that I needed to get clear on. So, well, I came back that night and asked for another appointment the next day. And so the next day I had the appointment. And again, so that time I was able to cut through those questions that he posed before me. So he confirmed that, yes, this is an experience that in Zen we call the so-called enlightenment experience. And so from now on, your practice is going to be from a different angle. Now, to be able to fathom the depths and height and breadth of all that through what is known as koan practice. So it's now something like having gotten hold of the master key. So now with that key, well, you have now entered that vestibule or that new dimension. But now the thing is to have that key and try to work at all the possible doors to that, so that you can also lead others into it freely in your own way. So from then on, well, of course, the koan practice continued. And so in our tradition, there are about 500 or 600 such koans, and people take their own time. I myself continued with that koan practice, being able to go for doksan maybe 2 or 3 times a month. And so it took me about 15 or 16 years to complete the whole set, with of course a lot of good guidance from Yamada Roshi. Some who were able to go into more session than I was able to do, because I was also studying full-time then. And also after studying, I also had a full-time job teaching at the university, and of course had to produce in terms of research and so many other things. So I took my time with the koans, but the others who were able to devote more time to just sitting and to session could go through the process in about 7 or 8 years. And so with that, more and more people came from Europe and from other parts of the Philippines, from the Philippines also and other parts of Asia, who wanted to also receive direction from Yamada Roshi. And so after so many years, right now there are about, well, close to 20 people who have gone through that formation and have been given that kind of permission by Yamada Roshi to also teach Zen to those that would sit with them. So that was a kind of a formative period in this whole process, I believe.
Did you have any sort of presentiment of what it would mean for the church that this was beginning to happen?
Well, for one thing, I had to continue questioning what this implies for my own understanding of what I had been calling God all along, or now the question of the place of Jesus Christ, or what is then the message of Christianity to the world in this context, that we see that there is something from the Zen tradition that really touches on those basic things that I had also been helped to approaching from within my own Christian tradition. And so that was a very, very critical period in my life, wherein I had to look anew at those basic expressions of what I had learned from the Christian faith, and try to see them in the context of this new experience that I was being led into. Are they the same? Or is it something different, and so on. And so fortunately, I was also given a lot of help, because I was in my theological formation process at that time. I was doing my theological studies, preparing for ordination to the priesthood. And so I got all the help from scripture scholars and from theologians, systematic theologians. Not that I got them in classes. The classes were just the same in terms of the traditional way of conducting classes then. But with the questions I had, I was able to, well, approach individuals and throw questions at them, and also do a lot of reading on my own and really try to fathom what this Christian message is all about. And that kind of questioning within me somehow enabled me to see, or rather to read Christian scriptures from a perspective that somehow leads to experience and not just interpret them theologically. So reading scripture, for example, well, the letters attributed to Paul, especially the Ephesians, Colossians, and Philippians, somehow they were also expressions of something that triggered a very similar experience in me, an experience similar to what I had been blessed with in that experience of awakening in Zen. So I tried to look into that a little more. Now, when Paul, for example, talks about being in Christ, who is from the beginning of creation, and that Christ who is also at the fount of all, who will become the core, the head, the core and the head, then, well, the Greek phrase, anakephalaiosastai, to put all things under one foundation or head, to cap all things, and so on. So the summit of creation, the ground of creation before the beginning of time, the Alpha and the Omega. So all these mind-boggling terms, which were in these letters of Paul, now came to me not just as concepts anymore, but something that pointed to that same dimension that I somehow felt overwhelmed by in that Zen experience. And so now reading those passages became new triggers for me to re-enter that same experience. And so I say boldly same, because for me it is the same, although conceptually, again, people would say, no, but don't you have to distinguish and so on. But within the same person, those words of Paul, and of course words in, say, the Sermon on the Mount or other words that you could read in other New Testament passages, somehow also triggered, again, a new experience that was based on that original one that started with the Zen awakening experience. So in that context, I began to really appreciate the Christian message as it is expressed in the New Testament in a way that somehow refers to a basic experience and a basic way of seeing reality. And so those terms now, for example, in Christ, or the basic message that the reign of God is at hand, have a change of heart, metanoia. So that means really change your way of seeing from one that is centered on the ego that always wants to aggrandize itself, I, me, mine, and let that ego die with Christ on the cross and open it to the newness of life. So all these terms that we use in our Christian tradition come to a new life based on that experience. And so now it is a reappropriation of the gospel message and of the New Testament message based on this experience that has been there through 1,500 years of this Oriental tradition. So it's now a meeting of those two spiritual traditions in those persons who also find their source of self-understanding and identity from the Christian expressions and so on. And so that is a journey that I am continuing at this point, to still continue to deepen that experience and purify it so that anything that would mar it or would becloud it would always be polished off. And it's a daily process, and it's a continual process, because one cannot just say, now I've had it. One has to continually come back to that source, just as God is a living God, the God of our ancestors, and the God who is leading us now towards the greater fulfillment of God's reign, and not something that just happened in the past and now we have to carry that as a memory. So in that sense, the hope is that this encounter of these two spiritual traditions will lead to a new birth where more and more can see that, yes, we are living basically in a reality that escapes our conceptualizations and our verbalizations, but yet which we have to refer to by verbs, by our words and by our concepts. And so in that sense, well, to go off on a similar point or a related point, Zen has a principle that says it does not rely on words or concepts, but makes use of them. Well, I'm just pointing that out as an addition, that basically the reality that Zen practice leads us to or awakens us to is something that can never be caged in adequately in words or concepts or letters. But being human, being embodied in language, we are condemned to using language, to borrow from Sartre an expression from another context. And being such embodied beings, the language we use also can be very, very crucial in opening us to that reality. So for those who have been living in a Christian tradition but are now beginning to feel really constricted by the institutional forms of ritual and practice and belief, and they are being fed with a lot of dead material in terms of dead wood, in terms of not living faith witness, but simply concepts and letters and repetitions of rituals and so on, they feel no longer nourished by those things, and so they are looking for something living. Now, while looking for something living and seeing that, well, in Christian communities now, there are certain elements there that somehow leave them dissatisfied. So in that sense, it is simply a matter of trying to reconsider what has been there all along, but which has been covered by a lot of the human element in terms of the ritualization and the routinization of so many things. And so I believe that this encounter with the Zen tradition will reopen to Christians the wealth that is found right within their own tradition, our own tradition.
Why was Yamada so open to doing this when even his own teacher was less enthusiastic? What were the, do you have any sense of what made him so open to do this? And he gives a tremendous gift to the Catholic Church, for example.
Yes.
What brought it about?
Well, I believe it is just meeting living Christians who were serious about their faith commitment, but yet wanted to really experience their faith genuinely and not just concerned with clinging to its concepts and so on. So he met Christians who were really sincere in their practice and realized that, yes, I have to take this seriously also. So in that sense, he was open because of that living encounter with living persons whom he felt he was called to respect. And so when he guided those of us who were practicing in that way, he realized, yes, maybe there's something here that goes beyond the stereotypes we've had of them before. And so he was able to go through those, or go beyond those stereotypes in meeting living personalities who were able to resonate in the very same dimension that he was directing others in Zen.
Can you tell us that story when he met with you and Father LaSalle and asked you some questions? How did that come about?
Well, actually, I was interviewing him then, and he asked, now, when you Christians do Zen, he asked, first of all, is there something lacking in your tradition that makes you come to Zen? Something outside, literally, of your own tradition? So the response to that would be that, no, it's not that it's lacking. Well, Father LaSalle had his own response saying, well, he began Zen in the attempt to understand more about Japanese culture. So Father LaSalle came as a missionary, and so with that missionary zeal of his, he said, well, you could not really fathom the depths of this culture unless you also participated in the very religious dimension that vivifies this culture. And so that's how Father LaSalle entered this practice of Zen. But I myself gave a different answer, saying that, well, for me, well, in my own journey, having been initiated into spiritual practice through the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius, I felt that seeing how this process of making oneself still in one's posture and breathing and focusing one's mind to a point of stillness, which is the basic structure of Zen practice, somehow also enables me to just open my whole being to that dimension that I had already felt I was being led to with the spiritual exercises, but this in a more direct way. And so in that sense, that hunch that I began with literally came to its fruition. So in that sense, my answer to Yamada Roshi was that, no, not that it's lacking, not that the Christian tradition is lacking, that we have to turn to Zen, but that as we need this way of practice, somehow the treasures in our tradition are opened up in our encounter with what Zen offers to us. So that was one question that he asked when we had the interview with him. And so with that, again, the second level of his challenge was, now, as Christians, I invite you to try to express what you have experienced in Zen, of course, realizing that it can never be simply exhausted in concepts or words. Yet, in your own language, I invite you to develop that and present it to those who would feel at home in that language, precisely to be able to go beyond that language and reach a point of experience. And so that was the second level of challenge that he hurled at us. And I think many of those who are now teaching Zen in their own places are trying to respond to that challenge, and it's still an ongoing process at this point.
And didn't he ask you a question about the origin of God?
Ah, yes.
And what did you say?
Well, I would not want
don't
to
answer
me,
but
yes,
I
won't.
Just in
and that's right. Well, one of the basic questions about, or rather, one well, basically just to go through the structure of a koan. A koan is a question or a puzzle or an anecdote that challenges the practitioner to crack through rational inquiry and open oneself to experience. Because if you try to just work at it by reason, you'll just get into a corner where there's no way out. So you have to just literally explode that whole situation and see it from an entirely different perspective. Anyway, well, one of the initial koans is, or one of the koans that has been helpful to so many in opening to that experiential dimension is the so-called mu koan, a koan on mu. Now, the classic anecdote goes that a monk asked Zen master Joshu, "Does a dog have Buddha nature?" And Joshu's answer was mu. Now the practitioner is invited to answer the question, "What is mu?" But mu answered not as an intellectual question, but mu that comes right out of the heart of your own Zen experience. So working through that koan can take not just months, sometimes not just years, but tens, twenties. Father LaSalle said he was working at it for nearly 30 years before he finally got some inkling as to what it was, and before he was passed the koan. But after being able to answer that, having been checked as far as the genuineness of it as an experience, the next question is, well, since the process is open, the next question is, what then is the origin of mu? And so for some Christians, asking that question, the origin of mu, then Yamada Roshi would present a variation of that. Now, for Christians, well, maybe my wife Maria would be in a better way to understand this, because she herself was asked this question after she also passed through the initial koan questions. What is the origin of God? And so rather than my own, well, for me, that was a boner. And so it took me really some time to be able to wrestle with it and so on. So I had to keep coming back and forth to Yamada Roshi, because I tried to keep working at it through my intellect. And so he said, no, you can't do it with those usual ways you've been trying to answer things up to now. But so it's a point when you see the utmost limits of what your rational inquiry can lead you to, that you can own. It's only when you reach those limits that you can see what lies beyond those limits. So the answer to that koan, what is the origin of God, can only be genuinely understood after you have gone through that process of really working it out through rational inquiry and realizing that that will not lead you anywhere. So it's like trying to scratch an itch on your foot without taking off your shoe. So the thing there is to try to take off your shoe, and then finally you're relieved. Aha! So in that kind of situation, it's trying to it's reworking your whole perspective entirely. And so Maria relates to me that she was given that koan during a session, and so she literally, you know, was overwhelmed by it when she discovered what it means. You know, she could not help but really crying with gratitude and joy, and as well as with so many mixed feelings at realizing how simple it is, and yet we block ourselves from it because of our own pride in the use of our own intellect and so on. It's not that we abandon our intellect because we need to see things in terms of their connections and so on. So while respecting its function as far as it can go, yet at a certain point we still have to realize also that it has to reach that point precisely where we have to leap beyond it. And only in leaping as such can we be able to see what grounds that intellect itself. So that's really a very, very crucial question also, that kills off the ego that wants to still to know in that sense. So the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, as the Genesis story goes, is the temptation that presented itself to Adam and Eve. So they wanted that fruit, and when they ate of that fruit, then they became separate from God and from their own true selves and from the rest of creation. Now, in a sense, it is our wanting to know, which is so natural in us, as Aristotle says, the human natural desire to know is what makes us human. But also, without realizing where it came from and without realizing where it's going, if we just cling to that as a way of aggrandizing our ego, that can prevent us really from continuing to be in touch with its own origin. So in that sense, it is overcoming that separation that the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil has wrought upon humankind.
How are we going to go and relate our own mystical tradition to this other tradition, which is so similar and yet doesn't always seem to coincide?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How are we going to relate those two?
Well, that's a good question. And I myself saw the task before us when I myself was just early on in Japan. It was in the early 70s. I had just barely learned to speak the language and read and write a little of it. And I was fortunate in having met some very good friends. And one of those that I was helped by was a Japanese Sunday school teacher who became good family friends. So she has since passed on, but she also shared with me aspects of her own faith journey and how she was helped a lot by many missionaries who came from the West, and of course by many Japanese Catholic nuns also. But anyway, she says, you know, these missionaries, well, when they come here and then they, for example, were standing together and looking at a sunset, they would always say, "Ah, what a beautiful sunset. Thanks be to God who created that sunset." But for us, that second sentence is entirely redundant. While we are there just beholding the beauty of the sunset, that really already speaks to us of that dimension. And we don't have to verbalize it. And when we do verbalize it, it somehow cheapens that reality that we are experiencing. So maybe, she said, that's the difference between the Japanese intuitive approach to reality and, say, a Western approach that has to verbalize certain things in that way, otherwise it's not satisfied with the way things are. But from a different context, the very act of verbalization somehow puts the awareness on a different level. So just to be able to stand and behold the sunset together and perhaps have some tea together and just be basking in that presence. Now, that doesn't mean that you're always silent and so on, but to be able to speak in a way that does not mar that presence, and so to speak even in that way, now I am in the presence of God, already puts that awareness on a second level of reflection that separates you from that primal experience. And so in that sense, I would say we need to be more careful precisely of purifying that experience and not just to trust the words that try to point on experience. Because, well, words in many ways really can be masks for things that are not clear in us. And so we use words to muddle up things. So we have to be clearer and really to continue purifying that experience. Now, for example, when we look at a flower, the very next moment when we are able to say, I am looking at a flower, we're no longer looking at the flower. So we have to continue to treasure those precious moments when we are really looking at the flower and not those moments after that when we say we have been looking at the flower.
How can you situate Zen experience mm-hmm. between our own metaphysical experience and our mystical experience?
Oh boy, that really is a hard one. And I have to sort out a few things there. First of all, when we use the word faith, I would like to understand that not so much as believing in here at the top of my head that there is a God or that there is such and such, or believing that this proposition is true. But I would like to understand it more in the Johannine sense, perhaps, of that sense of entrusting. And so it is a way of opening my being which disposes me to know, or maybe in the Augustinian sense also, that in order to know, one must first love. And so in that context, faith, for me, or in the understanding that I would like to continue in, would be that it is a basic stance already, a basic stance of openness and trusting, that faith in the gospel, that metanoia, which is presupposed in that act or in that disposition of oneself. So that opening of myself disposes me to really know in a direct way. So in that context, it is akin to what you might call, mystical knowledge in that sense. So that stance of faith presupposes, or rather is presupposed in any kind of knowing that we can call mystical. Now, in that context, then the kind of knowledge that is spoken of, well, as Paul says, is through a glass darkly, because it will not fall under certain ways of expression, namely in very matter-of-fact propositional language, because as Kant has shown, there are certain antinomies that we run into. We can say opposite things about that reality, and yet somehow those opposite things have their grounds for being said, and so we come to a coincidence of opposites, so to speak, coincidentia oppositorum. And so that direct knowledge with that stance of faith inevitably comes to a point where that opposition has to be maintained. If you just take one side of the opposition, then you're already one-sided and somehow closing in, or rather being in danger of idolatry. And so in that sense, that distinction certainly has to be maintained, that, well, it's a kind of knowledge that what we know as metaphysical knowledge can only try to point to by clarifying the distinctions beyond which, or rather with which, we use language. And so in that sense, for example, the time-worn notion of the analogy of being is precisely a way of pointing out that real being with a capital B must be distinguished from the beings with a small b, those beings that can be objects of our perception. And so it's only when you have seen that the ground of being is not just that being, but yet also envelops that being. So one has to go through it through a process of negation. And then that's when you can get that sense that, yes, that ground of being cannot just be equated with any being. And so that kind of dialectic is what we have to undergo. But the very term itself easily lends to a lot of pitfalls, and that's why from the Orient we have the term absolute nothingness. Now again, that can be crystallized and idolized into some kind of notion that can militate against what it tries to point to, but it has the advantage of precisely being less susceptible to conceptualization. And so for me, that term absolute nothingness is more like a critical principle that challenges us to continually negate our concepts, even the concept of absolute nothingness or God, in order to be able to touch that which is trying to point to. So in that sense, that knowledge that you point to or ask about is something that can come only with the dialectic of negation, affirmation, and further negation, and so on. And then where does that leave us? With the realization that our language and our conceptual frameworks can never exhaust the reality that we are always invited to behold. And so whether you come to it from the Western philosophical tradition, where it has all the terminological apparatus that you would need to be able to point to that, yet, or whether you come to it from the Oriental tradition with its own very direct and intuitive way of pointing to that, maybe the point there is that these two traditions need not be seen as diametric opposites or unable to relate to one another, but precisely in undergoing that dialectic in their own distinct ways, we can see that, hey, maybe we are resonating in certain areas, and we are talking about a certain dimension that we are expressing in diametrically opposite terms, like, well, from the Orient there is the notion of emptiness, whereas from the Western tradition the notion of fullness. Now when one has reached that fullness, again one has to go beyond the logical categories that one would naturally feel one has to follow, and so on. So those two terms which look so opposite, emptiness on the one hand and fullness on the other, somehow point to that dimension. And so now let's converse and see whether there are resonances in what we mean by these different terms. So I believe that that is an ongoing task, and this kind of conference on Buddhist-Christian dialogue, or when people who are really sincere about their path to the mystery meet one another, meet others from different traditions, and precisely try to see where they can resonate with one another, I think we are able to widen our own field, whereby more and more of us can see that we need not divide ourselves by our terminology, but that we can actually realize our connectedness beyond language, and see that our language does not have to be something that divides us at all, but we can relativize our use of language and see that there is something much deeper and much bigger than what we can contain in our little minds. So the question, is awakening experience different from Christian contemplation or infused contemplation, or are they the same? And so in that kind of questioning, which really is a question from the outside on the analytical plane, I am not prepared to answer as yet, because, well, the question presupposes a certain framework that I find I have to assume. And so, speaking from a more direct approach to things, again, when I am just here as I sit now, the question is, well, so from the very fact of being, I use the word being with a hyphen there to point to it as something dynamic. Now, what is involved in that? So again, that would lead me to, the very attempt to try to express it in this way would somehow put me into a certain mental framework that is now different from speaking directly from the experience. And so I'm not going to make any sense now. So again, the question though of when one sits in Zen, for example, the question of many Christians is, are they praying? I think that's a valid question, and that has to be taken in a very matter of fact way, that for many Christians the question of prayer is something crucial to their life of faith. Now, the way I respond to that is by pointing out that Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, I believe, invites Christians to pray without ceasing. Now, what does that mean, to pray without ceasing? Is it just to keep muttering prayers without stopping? And if so, then we have our physical limits to that. We can go on for a certain number of times and so on. But to pray without ceasing, literally, 24 hours of my waking and sleeping day, my whole being then is invited to be a prayer. So prayer then, in the way that Paul is really inviting us to, is a way of being and no longer just an intentional act of something. So I would like to respond affirmatively to the question, when one just sits, am I praying? Or when I just take a walk, am I praying? Or when I brush my teeth, am I praying? The crucial point there is, am I disposed in a way that my whole life and my whole being is offered to God as a prayer? And that is the condition for my being able to say yes, so that everything I do or everything that happens to me is a prayer of gratitude, of praise, of repentance, and also of petition. And I can analyze the different dimensions of that, but it's that my whole being in everything I do then is not separate from my life of faith. Now, if you mean by prayer something very, very limited in terms of an intentional act of addressing something to God, then perhaps you have to say, not in that sense, but precisely in realizing that prayer is something that we are invited to partake in with our whole being, then the question rather should be phrased as, how can my whole life be a prayer? And for me, Zen practice is a very, very powerful way of precisely opening myself and enabling my whole being to be emptied in a way that God can fill that and God can take over my life, rather than my ego wanting to control and direct things, even my own prayer life.
how is the Christian Zen practitioners going to deal with the central role of Jesus
mm-hmm,
and
yes.
mm-hmm. question of the personal God?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Could you kind of reflect a little bit of the kind of difficulties you see in integrating Zen within the Catholic Church?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, these are central questions that will have to be addressed. And each one has to address it in one's own way, because, well, to be Christian implies that one professes a self-understanding that comes from the message of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ has to be at a central position there. But do you put Jesus Christ in a central position in a way that identifies it with just a historical event that happened 2,000 years ago and unrelated to the present? Or when you say, well, yes, Jesus Christ yesterday, today, and tomorrow, does that bring that reality into our everyday life here and now, so that with Paul we can say to live is Christ? And in the same way also, we all live in Christ, and so that Christ has to die precisely. That Christ that we box in our own little concepts has to die on the cross precisely in order to be able to live again yesterday, today, and tomorrow, in a way that we become the embodiment of that Christ that was there before the foundation of the world. So in that sense, for the Christian, there's no question about it. Christ is at the center, and Jesus is the way to tell us what the Christ is all about. And so we are able to participate in that mystery of Christ and are able to see our oneness precisely in that whole mystery that God has been unfolding throughout the ages and even now, and as we continue from moment to moment. And again, the notion of God, no longer seen as some being out there, but precisely the very ground of our being as we breathe in and breathe out. The very source also of everything that happens, and also the very orientation of all these things. And so in that way, we need to untangle those very limited boxes. We have to untie those knots that we have put on those words, God and Jesus Christ, and enable them to come back to a living reality from moment to moment. There's no question about that. So for the Christian, those are crucial issues.